before Sunday school. There will be hot chocolate, cookies, and apple juice, so it should be nice. And on this Wednesday, December 17th, the Eggs group invites you for a special program of music with our music director, Mr. Kennan. There will be some Christmas carols, holiday music, and we ask that you bring maybe a friend and a side dish. And there are still offering envelopes available for 2015 by the Brandywine High School side entrance. So to cut down on postage, unless you specifically request it, we won't be mailing them out. You can pick them up over there. And also pledges for 2015. We've already received 110 for $427,076, which is great for the operating budget of 2015. And if you haven't pledged already, we hope that you can do it as soon as possible. And they're available from ushers on Sundays and in the church office during the week. And there's also the holiday concert, Opus 1 Vocal Arts, next Sunday, December 21st at 7. And it's free, but we suggest that you make a $10 donation, and it should be great, featuring a lot of music. And then this Friday, the youth Christmas party will be there from 6 to 9 p.m., and we hope that you bring a white elephant gift of $5, and it should be a good time. Mrs. Kennan was planning that. And also, there are alternative Christmas gifts out in the narthex. So instead of giving more things, you could consider alternative Christmas gift giving. And if you check out the poster, there'll be more details. Does anybody else have any announcements? First hymn is 2091, not 2019. Anyone else? Okay, let's begin with the prelude.
Rejoice always and pray without ceasing. Just as the Israelites petitioned God for deliverance from captivity, refugees and asylum seekers are desperate for deliverance from persecution today. Their tears water the ground as they flee their homes and leave their lives behind. Their prayers rise up to heaven as they languish for years in refugee camps. Their frustrations silently mount as they face discrimination and apathy in their new homeland. At such times, God's promises of eventual deliverance, justice, and joy can seem distant. Yet the coming of Christ this Advent season gives us reason to rejoice despite our troubled world. We can rejoice always, knowing that salvation will come, that justice will be served, and that those who go out weeping will one day return with songs of joy. The pain of this world too often overwhelms us. Constant tragedies, senseless violence seem to steal our hope. God's promises give us light in the darkness.
Rejoice always.
Good morning. Good morning. Okay, all right. Please join me for the prayer of praise and adoration. Your Spirit is upon us, O God, because you have anointed us to bring good news to the oppressed, to bind up the brokenhearted, to proclaim liberty to the captives, and release to the prisoners. To proclaim the year of the Lord's favor and to comfort all who mourn. This is all your doing, and it is wonderful in our sight. As we pass through the portals of your sanctuary, we come bringing our hymns of praise and thanksgiving. Be pleased with our worship as we bless your name. Amen.
Good morning. Today's reading is John chapter 1, verses 6 through 8, and verses 19 through 28. There came a man sent from God whose name was John. He came as a witness to testify about the light, so that all might believe through him. He was not the light, but he came to testify about the light. This is the testimony of John. When the Jews sent him priests and Levites from Jerusalem to ask him, "Who are you?" And he confessed and did not deny, but confessed, "I'm not the Christ." They asked him, "What then? Are you Elijah?" And he said, "I am not." "Are you the prophet?" And he answered, "No." Then they said to him, "Who are you, so that we may give an answer to those who sent us? What do you say so that about yourself?" He said, "I am a voice of one crying in the wilderness, 'Make straight the way of the Lord,' as Isaiah the prophet said." Now they had been sent from the Pharisees. They asked him and said to him, "Why then are you baptizing, if you are not Christ, nor Elijah, nor the prophet?" John answered them, saying, "I baptize in water, but among you stands one whom you do not know. It is he who comes after me, the thong of whose sandal I am not worthy to untie." These things took place in Bethany beyond the Jordan, where John was baptizing. This is the word of the Lord.
Can I have all the children up for the children's message?
Hi guys, how was your week? Good. I have something to show you today. You guys can like do that. Do you know what this is, Emma?
It's the set that shows people that came when Jesus was born.
Mm-hmm. It's called a nativity scene.
There were a lot of animals in the stable. Do you know what they are? What's this one? Oh, good try. It's an ox. What about this one? Donkey. It's a donkey, but good try. And what about this one? Yeah.
The shepherd brought his sheep to the stable when an angel told him that a king was going to be born.
These are the three wise men. They came from the east riding on camels, bringing gifts for the soon-to-be-born baby.
Do you know what the three gifts were?
Gold, myrrh.
Gold and myrrh.
And frankincense.
Gold, myrrh, and frankincense. Each gift had a special meaning. Gold was fit for a king. Myrrh was a burial spice that symbolized Jesus' death. And frankincense was used in worship because it had a nice scent.
Last but not least, we have Mary and Joseph. They traveled to Bethlehem riding on a donkey.
I feel like something really important is missing, guys. Do you know what it is?
Baby Jesus.
Yeah, baby Jesus isn't here yet. When is baby Jesus gonna come? Christmas is when we celebrate the birth of Jesus.
Right now, we are waiting for Jesus, just like Mary and Joseph did.
Will you pray with me? Dear God, thank you for all the people and animals that were present at Jesus' birth, and for the time we spend waiting for your son. Amen.
Amen. Have a good week, and remember to be on the lookout for Jesus.
Thank you. Oh, there we go. Right on. Okay. Good morning. For the fourth time. So often in today's society, we use words in the wrong way. And I'm not just talking about using the wrong form of the word your or putting apostrophes where they ought not to be. We've forgotten the difference between denotation and connotation. Now, for those of you who are just lost, denotation is the dictionary definition of a word, and connotation is its social meaning, like its underlying messages. And don't think I'm just a know-it-all. Those were two words in a vocabulary test we had last year, and they just sort of stuck in my head. But I digress. We have this mentality of, oh, well, I knew what I meant, and it's their fault if they didn't know. But that's really the situation that starts many of our problems. What one person perceives as a harmless joke, another can find to be a brutal insult. What one person sees as an innocent compliment, another sees as inappropriate. Words can really get us in a lot of trouble if we aren't careful with the ones that we choose to use. Some words are frequently used the wrong way in the church, and I thought that maybe I'd give you a vocabulary lesson today. And hopefully these new definitions will stick in your head, like the word connotation for me. I found in my short 17 and a half years of life that I tend to be a little different, and I think about things in a way that not many other people do. But I think today I'll give you a brief preview into the way I see the world. So here goes, and bear with me. Tolerance has been a really big topic lately in the church and in the whole world. From race, to culture, to language, to style, to sexual orientation, to favorite color, prejudice exists in every category. So of course we want to bring up this difficult topic and open it up to show the world a new way to live in this world without prejudice. We call this tolerance. But I think that the real word we should be using is acceptance. Dictionary.com says that tolerance is a fair, objective, and permissive attitude toward opinions and practices that differ from one's own, and acceptance is a favorable reception, approval, or favor. So tolerance sort of exists in the way that when you see Brussels sprouts on your dinner plate, you don't go crazy and throw them across the room. And acceptance exists when you cram those sprouts in your mouth, even though they aren't your favorite thing, and you eat them, because someone went to all the trouble to make them for you. Now, that analogy's a little weird, but it gets my point across. Tolerance is just letting something exist without fighting it, which is step one, granted. But it isn't the entire process. From step one, we have to move on to step two, which is to love everyone and truly accept them, differences and all. I found online that the New Revised Standard Edition of the Bible includes the word love 538 times. That's a lot. The word hate only occurs 94 times. So why do so many Christians spend their days preaching hate in the name of the Lord, when really, he only spends a very short time discussing it? The Bible talks about love more than 5 times for every 1 mention of hate. God doesn't associate himself with hatred. He's a loving God who accepts us all. I'm sure you've heard that one before, that God accepts everyone regardless of sin. Note that you've never heard of God tolerating us. He doesn't just let us exist. He accepts and loves us. We spend so much time trying to be perfect and holy, but so many of us reject that principle. When we think of our sins, we don't usually consider that commandment that we break so often, love thy neighbor as thyself. God didn't say, love thy neighbors that are exactly the same as thy, as thou self. What? Love thy neighbors that are exactly as same as thou, as thyself. That was hard. Okay. He just wanted us to love our neighbors. All of them. Christianity isn't about changing people. It's about accepting them and bringing them to God. The scripture today includes Psalm 126. It says, "When the Lord restored the fortunes of Zion, we were like those who dreamed. Our mouths were filled with laughter, our tongues with songs of joy. Then it was said among the nations, the Lord has done great things for them. The Lord has done great things for us, and we are filled with joy." Another scripture from today was 1 Thessalonians 5. It says, "Rejoice always, pray continually, give thanks in all circumstances, for this is God's will for you in Christ Jesus. Do not quench the spirit. Do not treat prophecies with contempt, but test them all. Hold on to what is good. Reject every kind of evil. May God himself, the God of peace, sanctify you through and through. May your whole spirit, soul, and body be kept blameless at the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. The Bible talks of God's unending love for us and how we must keep ourselves full of joy and love. George Orwell once said, "Happiness can only exist in acceptance." We must take everyone equally and love them all so that we can show them the way to Christ. We can't be the thing that stands in between the hurting and the open arms of the Lord. So let's start today in a new world, not of tolerance, but of true acceptance. It might take a lot for some of our more stubborn people, but it's what God wants for us. God has made your dinner, and he doesn't just want you to eat your soft Hawaiian roll. He wants you to, well, suck it up and eat the Brussels sprouts too. Your parents told you when you were little, if you don't clean your plate, you can't have dessert. We can't be truly happy until we accept everyone, regardless of who they are. Everyone has challenges in their life and in their faith, but we need to face them with courage and determination to do what God wants of us. That's not to say that we're never going to sin, we're never going to make mistakes. We're human, and we will make mistakes. But, like John the Baptist said in today's scriptures, Jesus is the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world, and he will forgive us. Thank you.
Thank you. share today? Keep her in our prayers. Anyone else?
After 52 hours of labor, my sister had a healthy baby boy. Thank God.
Greetjoy. Anyone else? Okay, join me in a word of prayer. Lord, make me an instrument of your peace. Where there is hatred, let me sow love. Where there is injury, pardon. Where there is doubt, faith. Where there is despair, hope. Where there is darkness, light. Where there is sadness, joy. O divine master, grant that I may not so much seek to be consoled as to console, not so much to be understood as to understand, not so much to be loved as to love. For it is in giving that we receive, it is in pardoning that we are pardoned, it is in dying that we awake to eternal life. And if you would join me in saying the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Thank you.
As you go forth to serve in the world, allow the peace of Christ to guard your hearts. Let the word of Christ dwell in you richly. And whatever you do, in word or deed, do everything in the name of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks to God the Father through him.